Kyle, how's it going?
Good, how you doing, Chad?
Pretty good. So I just wanted to check in on this gingerbread house manufacturing process. This is a pretty awesome part that Mastercam Partnerships and Hermle are working together on. So tell us a little bit about it.
Yeah, so you know, you guys had come to us with a great idea for a wonderful holiday project. And once we took a look at this, we said this is definitely something that belongs on a Hermle and something we really wanted to tackle and work with you guys on.
Absolutely. So tell us, what's the machine you're running this on?
So we are running this on our C42 dynamic machine. This is a full five-axis machine. We do have the 25K spindle on this machine as well, and the torque table, so we can really move around the A and C axis.
And I believe the way that we worked this was we actually prepared the blanks in our Mastercam office in Tolland to set up on this rock lock fixture and ship them out to you. So how's that fixturing working out?
It's working wonderful. You know, I was out of the office, and when I came back, I had that skid of material waiting for me. I had all the rock lock fixturing waiting for me. We were throwing chips in no time.
The partnerships team went through and programmed this thing, and then you helped us to make it real, right? Like, obviously, your knowledge of that Hermle machine is key to making this a successful project.
Yeah, so obviously, with this being a mesh here, you know, there's a lot of tools and a lot of strategies that have to be, you know, well thought out and well executed on this. And that's where, you know, working with you guys, it was great for me. I got to learn a lot of different things on how you guys attack this, and to see you guys work as a team through programming this and overcoming some challenges, you know, but then being able to say, hey, all right, I see this toolpath. I don't like the look of this toolpath. Here's the reasonings. Here's the, you know, the past experiences I've had. Some of this too, we've even put into practice and cut and visually seen for ourselves, so I could share with the partners team, you know, the results that we saw on the screen versus the results we get on the machine, make the appropriate changes. And, you know, it's typically a checkbox away, and all of a sudden we have just jewelry sitting in the machine. So,
yeah. So I'm looking at some of the features on here. You're actually going to try to machine these with undercuts on the backside, right?
Not try. It's already been done. We have it on the machine right now. It looks amazing. It really sets off this piece here, this demo piece. I mean, if you just picture like just a solid STL here, and you didn't have the overhang of the icicles, and you didn't have some of these features sticking out like they do, it's basically just a box at that point.
Well, just looking at these icicles and just curious how these are even programmed. So it looks like it's full five-axis slotting you're doing?
Yes. Yes, using the full radius inserts on this slotting saw, you know, and the unified morph on here to get in there and actually work our way through there, staying off the windows, staying out of the icicles. But yeah, giving us room so we can come in with the finish tools and actually wrap around the icicles to finish them off. Because that's the biggest challenge with the icicles, is trying to finish them off. With all the material underneath, we just snap tools all day long. So,
right. I mean, that's really made a difference. I couldn't imagine any way of reaching anything inside of that undercut. That's crazy that you can actually get in there with a slotting tool and stay, like you said, stay safe on that window. So this is a pretty cool piece of Mastercam programming in here. I know we've got these really cool scallop tool paths up here for doing the shingles. And so it looks like these actually were programmed as three-axis operations, right? So we've got this equal scallop tool path, which makes a beautiful cut pattern, right? This, you can see the lines of this part are, it's going to make a really nice step over motion on the part itself. But when we analyze this toolpath, you know, we can't use this in three axis, right? We're in the middle of this chimney here. So you guys were able to use convert to five axis to actually add to a three axis toolpath and tilt this thing away. That's absolutely awesome that you could do such a, it's a really unique way of programming a part like this.
It keeps it very flexible because it puts a lot more tool paths at your fingertips. Some of the tool paths that we, even the legacy ones that we like to use, that give us a desirable finish, a desirable motion, you know. I know how this tool is going to react going through all this. And like you said, it's going to give us a beautiful grain structure to what we're doing with this icing or this snow on here. And yeah, being able to use just our simple three-axis path and not put too much into it, you know. One thing you guys do great with all your videos when you're teaching new stuff is you start at the basics, and let's just worry about cut pattern first and foremost, you know? So that's what we went with here, is what's our cut pattern. I want my cut pattern nailed. Let's not worry about the holder. Let's not worry about some other things right now. Let's get that cut pattern. After that, then it's a few clicks of collision control and doing some auto tilting, staying away. All right, don't hit this chimney now. And it gets to keep my cut pattern in place. And now I'm just going to roll around on that ball to still achieve the same cut pattern.
Yeah. Yeah, that's great. I mean, really, this convert to five axis is really underappreciated, right? Like, it's a obscure toolpath to use, but if you think about it as keep it simple, make your three axis motion first, and then make it safe, it's a pretty effective way of programming a multi-axis machine.
It is, and that's there's been a lot of nice little learning steps for me. Some of this is, you know, stuff I've been well aware of, and some of this stuff you just don't put into practice enough. And on a part like this, to see how much we actually use three-axis paths and did the convert to five-axis and are getting the surface finish I expect and I want to get out of our program and our machine and our tooling, it's been phenomenal. You know, and it's been resounding of what this is, let's go back to basics, let's keep it simple, then we can do this and you get a phenomenal product out.
So being machined on a Hermle, obviously we're looking for highest of high-end surface finishes, and this being a mesh, you know, it has a finite level of surface finish you could achieve because it's just triangles, right? So I know you guys have gone through some work where you've had to kind of change your approach of surface finishing. So in this case here, we can see this toolpath, you know, there's a very, you can barely even see it, but there's a little variation in the peaks that we're seeing in this toolpath here that created some inconsistencies that really only are being exposed because we're on such a high-end machine. Here's one you can see here is a little higher peak here than there. So can you tell us a little bit about what you found there?
Yeah, so on that, you know, and this is something that I have come across before on the Hermle machines here now, is some of these moves where we get into doing collision control and we're retracting, you know, we can step out to surface normals, we can step out along the XY plane, you know, tool axis. There's many different, you know, combinations we can use there. But some of those with this mesh don't give us a desirable result, where this was stepping out where it didn't need to. And yeah, we're looking at a couple micron there maybe, but it gave us a very scratchy surface on the actual machine surface. I understand that this is a mesh and there's a lot of triangles on here, but really with what we've been grown to expect is I want to see all those triangles actually show up on my part. It was really tough to see, but one of the giving factors is kind of when we looked at again at our toolpath, the direction we were cutting and then which way these scratches or lines were coming through as, it kind of pointed us in the direction. And only until we really started rotating this model around, because if you look at it from just a front view, right view, the path looks fine. You know, right. They look very equal distant going up vertical and stuff. You don't have too many problems. And then you hit one view where all of a sudden it's like, why is my gaps not looking correct there? And that was the big flag at that point, is my gaps didn't look the same and equal distant everywhere else. So let's take a look a little more into that. And then we saw the way that it was stepping out off of the surface. So we changed our collision a little bit and just our retracts and how we responded to that. And then we were able to get rid of that and have that nice smooth finish. And it is a very triangulated surface that comes through, which for this case of being, you know, it's kind of like a snow drapery, a snow landscape that we're looking at there. It really looks nice on there. But right. You know, seeing those first come through was interesting, yeah. And something you normally don't see.
And that's really the challenge of high-end multi-axis programming, right? Where, you know, you can have a toolpath here that looks great, right? I mean, we're totally happy with this, but just taking a different approach, and nothing wrong with that toolpath, but taking a different approach, you end up cleaning up a lot of those issues, and really with just a couple different different options checked on. So, yeah, it's an interesting thing that, you know, on such a high-end machine, you see these things. And luckily with Mastercam, we have the ability to help tailor our code to that machine.
No, and then that was the easy part too. You know, once we realized what was going on and what we saw there, you know, being able to go into our parameter pages, go in there, make a change, hit the apply button, I get to see the changes on the screen right away. I'll tell you, after all these years of running Mastercam, that's probably my greatest improvement you guys have made, yeah. Is that I can update it inside of there, get my quick view, because I'm able to zoom in on my problem corner. I can make my changes, see how it affects it. I don't even have to move my screen around. I can go make another change, hit the apply button, and I'm able to see all this generate for me live, and I can just get it done right away. So
right.
It was very simple.
Right, nothing better than being able to work on your part, your toolpath, while seeing your part at the same time. That was a big one. I like it. Cool. Thank you for all this. I'm excited to see this thing running, and it should be pretty cool when the final result is out.
Excellent. No, it's been great working with you guys and working with the Mastercam product and being able to put it through its paces and, you know, put my knowledge through my paces and put our machine through. It's been a great project for, I think, all parties involved.
Absolutely. Hopefully it's going to be very successful, and we're looking forward to getting a finished piece shipped over here. So thanks for talking to us today, and we're excited to see that final result.
Excellent. Thanks, Chad.